Hello, I'm Bernie Hayes. Today we'll be talking about activism and social action with Reverend Darryl Gray today on The Bernie Hayes Show. Welcome back. I'm Bernie Hayes, and our guest is Reverend Darryl Gray. Reverend Gray, welcome back.
Thank you, Dr. Hayes. It's always an honor and a pleasure being with you. I've told you before, I'm very encouraged and inspired by your life's history and the work that you continue to do to educate and inform our communities.
Well, that's reciprocal, sir. That's same back to you.
Thank you.
And I mean that very sincerely.
Thank you very much.
So you've been traveling recently. Tell us about some of your travels.
Well, I had an opportunity to take some time off after the George Floyd verdict. That was an exhausting time for a lot of us. And so I was convinced to go visit my children, particularly, you know, post-pandemic or,
sure.
or almost post-pandemic. So I traveled to Cincinnati, West Virginia, and South Carolina. And while in South Carolina, I had an opportunity to visit with some old friends with the South Carolina Labor Council and sit down and help them to create a faith labor alliance there in South Carolina. So it was a lot of pleasure, a little bit of work, but it's good to be back home in St. Louis.
Mm-hmm. Sir, what does social justice look like now since the George Floyd
verdict? That is a wonderfully interesting question. I tell people that the verdict in the George Floyd murder trial is a continuation of this movement.
Mm-hmm.
I tell people, be very careful not to celebrate too quickly. It was the right verdict. He was guilty on all counts. You know, he had his knee on Mr. Floyd's neck for 9 minutes and 29 seconds. I think that the most critical moment in that trial was when the police chief came up and testified for the prosecution. I think that was an anomaly as it relates to police and policing in this country. I think it put a crack in the blue wall of silence.
Mm-hmm.
And it let police officers know that that it's okay to speak truth to power. It's, you know, be courageous, be forthright. And so I think that that was the most telling part of it. The bar is set so high, Mr. Hayes, in this country, as it relates to prosecuting a police officer with qualified immunity, with the police bill of rights, with the blue wall of silence. It is difficult, but justice prevailed for George Floyd and for his family, and I think for the country, but we have a long way to go.
I see. Expect Us, that's the organization that you formed. Tell us what that's about and its purpose, its mission.
Expect Us was created during the Stockley trial in 2017, right in the fall of 2017.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the organizers with Expect Us are organizers that started right during the Mike Brown murder in August of 2014. They stayed on the front line. They stayed active. And so when the Jason Stockley trial came up, we knew that we had to re-engage St. Louis, re-engage the police, re-engage the criminal justice system. And so church leaders, Ferguson activists came together and we formed what is now called Expect Us. Expect Us simply means if there is injustice, expect us. If there is a need to speak on the issue of police violence, then expect us. Expect us to show up in your boardrooms. Expect us to show up in City Hall and the county courthouse and in the intersections. We'll do what we need to do nonviolently to shake the system so that we once again can speak truth to power. Out of that group are people like Congresswoman Cori Bush. She's a member of Expect Us.
Sure.
State Representative Rasheen Aldridge, Ferguson City Councilwoman Fran Griffith, and so many more. And it, you know, it's an honor for me to be part of such a distinguished group of activists and elected officials, political leaders, mm-hmm. and public servants.
Not only do they expect you, but they should respect you also. Well, expect you and respect you.
Well, you know what, Dr. Hayes, you know, we put in the work. We make it very clear that we have to go from protests to politics to policy. And at the end of the day, if we're only protesting and not involved in the political system, not registering people to vote, educating voters, mobilizing voters, if we're not trying to shape public policy and government policy, then it's all about, it's all for naught. It's what I believe Dr. King would have wanted us to do. I believe it's what all of the civil rights icons, Rosa Parks, Fannie Lou Hamer, Shirley Chisholm, you name it. This is where I think they've brought us to, their memory, their activism, their spirit. And so that's what Expect Us is all about. We're not simply protesters. We are protesters, but we're also organizers. We're organizers, but we're also activists. We're activists, but we're also advocates as well.
Okay. So the tenets of your faith is actually in coordination with what you're doing, right? I mean, support your propositions.
Well, without question, I think that when you think about Dr. King and his ministry, it begins with the scripture that Christ read when he began his ministry in the book of Isaiah. When he opened the book and he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And then it begins to outline those things that we should be actively involved with in our ministry. The same things that, you know, Larry Rice is doing with feeding the homeless and housing the unhoused and providing clothes to those who are in need. The whole idea of being engaged in the community should be what the church is all about. Recovering of sight to the blind, speaking and preaching the acceptable year of the Lord. All of those things simply mean that as a church, we must be engaged. We must speak for the least of these. And that's my foundation. It was the foundation of Jesus Christ. It was the foundation of Dr. King. And I think as a black church in particular, but the church in general, I believe it was created not for Sunday morning service, but it was created for service for those who stand in the shadows of our steeples.
Amen. Let me ask you this too, sir, because although you're the organizer of Expect Us, you belong to many other organizations too, mostly progressive organizations.
Yes,
name
sir.
Some of them, please.
Well, I am the political advisor for the St. Louis Metropolitan Clergy Coalition. I am the chair for civic engagement for the Baptist Ministers Union of St. Louis and vicinity, and the 24-1 Clergy Coalition, which is a St. Louis organization. I serve as the social justice chair for the Progressive Missionary Baptist Convention and the social justice co-chair for the Missionary Baptist State Convention. I am the former chair of the Progressive Caucus of the Missouri Democratic Party. I serve as the regional chairperson for the Progressive Missionary Baptist Convention, and I serve as the national co-chair for the prison ministry for that same organization. I think you are aware that I'm a former state senator from Kansas, and I've done sundry other things. You know, all of this, Dr. Hayes, is who I am. It is my ministry. I am a progressive pastor.
Yes.
I believe that the church must be the headlight and not the taillight of social justice and social action.
How do you manage the time, sir? I mean, that's a time management problem. We're going to take a short break here, and I want to come back and discuss that with you. Now, and the missions of all the wonderful organization that you just mentioned.
Yes, sir.
But Reverend Gray, you're just so many places and doing so many wonderful things, and they're all positive, that it's hard to keep up with you. I want to take the time just right now just to let people know that we're 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri. And this is the New Life Evangelistic Center. And Reverend Larry Rice has been doing wonderful things for wonderful people for nearly 50 years. And those programs that were being administered down at 1411 Locust Street, which we're trying to reopen as a daycare facility, are now honored right here and produced that New Life at 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri. Back with Reverend Darryl Gray after this.
We already see so many homeless people. God only knows how many more are going to end up on the streets once the moratorium on evictions lift. So many hurting and homeless people and no place for them to go during the day, particularly in the downtown St. Louis area and even out in the county. So many hurting and homeless people left out in the streets and in the parks. Now, if we could just begin to work together to reopen 1411 Locust, things could change. We could do so many things at 1411 Locust that we're doing in Springfield at the day center we have there. So many people could be getting help at this time. As you know, New Life Evangelistic Center was closed by the Slay administration and the Crewson administration back in April of 2017. We've waited 4 years. Thank God we finally got a new administration that seems very sensitive to the needs of the homeless. Now your help is needed as an advocate, as a prayer warrior, that we can get back into the 1411 Locust building. We can do this if you'll go to God in prayer. Right now we're commissioning our architects to come up with new architectural plans. We had spent over $80,000, but each time it was being stopped by the Crewson and the Slay administration. Now with a new administration at hand, we believe that we'll be able to take steps forward to reopen this building. So homeless people that are now in the parks where they can't shower, they can't store their belongings, they can't use internet service to find jobs, they can't get the meals, and they just need clean clothes and so many direct services to store their belongings alike that we could help them with here at 1411 Locust. Please go to God in earnest prayer and encourage your family and friends and everyone you know to contact our present mayor's office. I believe she cares a lot about the homeless, but she needs to know you're standing beside her and you're with her at this particular time. So please continue to pray. Please be an advocate in behalf of the homeless. I thank God for what Bernie Hayes is doing through his program. So many wonderful guests that he has. Now, will you please support our efforts as we work together to reopen 1411 Locust?
2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come.
And welcome back. My guest is Reverend Darryl Gray, organizer for Expect Us. And Reverend Gray, you've been ministering all over the country. Why did you settle in St. Louis?
Cori Bush, or Congresswoman Cori Bush.
Sure.
I was working with the Southern Christian Leadership Conference out of Atlanta. I met Cori in Selma, Alabama at the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery March, where former President Obama was speaking.
Sure.
We met there. I invited her to speak at the SCLC convention in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and told her at that time that she and I were going to work together at some point. Little did I know that she was going to run for the United States Senate and called me to run her campaign.
Congress,
so I came to Missouri
Congress.
To run her campaign when she ran for Senate, worked with her when she ran for Congress the first time. And I came because of Cori, and I stayed because of, I think, the need that I saw in St. Louis as related to advocacy and activism, and wanting to work with people like Cori Bush and Bruce Franks and Rasheen Aldridge and Ohan Ash and Tori Russell and so many others. And I stayed. I stayed because I saw St. Louis, I saw Missouri, I saw the Midwest as the new South and the beginning of a new civil rights movement, and I wanted to be part of that.
Okay. What impact do you think Cori Bush's election will have on the region and the country in general?
I think Cori, the Congresswoman, has already made a huge impact because she wears her advocacy. She makes it very clear that she is not a politician and she's not trying to be a politician, that she is a servant of the public. She does not mince her words. She does not bite her tongue. And she speaks with a compassion and a genuineness that is very rare in the halls of Congress. She makes it very clear, Dr. Hayes, that she represents the people of the 1st Congressional District And she will represent them, no holds barred. And so I think that what she says to activists and advocates, young progressives, that if we put in the work, we can accomplish our task. She put in the work. Lacey Clay was a formidable opponent, but Corey outworked him. And it's important, Dr. Hayes, that people understand that in politics, particularly now, there are no entitlements. No one is entitled to a position. You have to continue to earn it, term after term, election after election. And Corey is pushing legislation that is critical. The George Floyd Policing Act, John Lewis Voting Rights Act, right. The For the People Act.
Sure.
These are things that she's going to push, and they're going to make a difference, not just in the 1st Congressional District, but across the country.
Mm-hmm. And I see Congresswoman Bush is also supporting the new mayor of the city of St. Louis, Tashara Jones. What impact do you think that will have on the region, the election of Tashara Jones?
Well, I think that the election of Mayor Jones, you know, is historical in its own sense, but I think it's more than historical. It's critical. I think that when you look at Mayor Jones, the fact that she came from the treasurer's position, the fact that she served in the state legislature, she comes with a wealth of experience. The fact that her dad is Vervis Jones, who is a political icon within this city and brings a wealth of political knowledge. The fact that progressives, black and white, supported her. I mean, if you look at the numbers, if it had not been for Alderwoman Megan Green, Alderwoman Annie Rice, Alderman Dan Gunther, and other progressive alder people, we wouldn't have a black mayor. It wasn't the black vote that elected Mayor Jones. It was white progressives. And so it shows very clearly that if you build these types of coalitions, you can win. Corey did it. Mayor Jones did it. What Mayor Jones has done out of the box is kept a lot of her promises in working to close the workhouse and bringing transparency and accountability to a police force, bringing on Dan Eisen as the interim public safety director,
sure.
And Heather Taylor
right.
As the senior advisor. Those are major moves in this city. And now, with $500 million of COVID money and putting together an advisory committee to help her to navigate through who's going to use this money, making sure that not defunding the police, but making sure that she allocates the adequate resources to crime prevention and not simply crime enforcement. I think that she's made a good start. I think if you look at Congresswoman Bush, you look at Mayor Jones, you look at Circuit Attorney Kim Gardner, you look at Prosecutor Wesley Bell, you look at Ella Jones out in Ferguson, you look at the two black councilwomen, Councilwoman Days and Councilwoman Sharonda Webb in the county. The region is beginning to move, I think, in a way that's definitely going to make a difference to black people in the region,
sure.
But I think the region as a whole.
Right. You know, with your theology degree, you didn't have to do what you're doing now. Why did you choose the path that you've taken, sir?
It is a call, Dr. Hayes. And I think about it on a regular basis. If I were not called to the social gospel, if I were not called to follow in the footsteps of Christ and to do the things that I believe Christ would do if he were on earth in a human sense, in a physical sense, it's why I do what I do. I wake up every morning asking what would Jesus do as it relates to voter suppression, as it relates to wealth disparity or health disparity, as it relates to the violence that is going on, that is plaguing our community, and how do we address it? How do we respond to it? And I honestly ask that question. And so I believe that the church, that our faith must issue in action, And I believe if we're not living out our faith in doing these types of things, if our religion does not translate in action, then it's, as Dr. King would say, a dry as dust religion. And it is why I do what I do. It's my calling.
And it's certainly a church and state certainly melded when they got you. There's no doubt about that. And you chose public service. You're choosing to do the good thing, the right thing, the progressive thing. And we admire you so much for it. We're going to take a very short break now and come back and talk about the other things that we must talk about with Reverend Darryl Gray. We'll be right back after this.
The Bernie Hayes Program is produced at NLEC TV right here at 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri. It's our new headquarters since they closed the 1411 Locust building. We're working to get back into that building. In addition to that, trying to help so many people through a wide variety of safe houses, training programs, transportation assistance, so many ways people are getting help because of all of you that are supporting the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. Now, if you'll send a gift of $25 or more, we want to send you this special, the Bernie Hayes Show Cup. And we're giving that to people as just a way of saying thank you. So when you send your gift, request a cup. We'll be happy to get it off to you. It's New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. You can give online at nlecstl.org. Now I'm really asking all of you to join us in praying. The needs are so phenomenal at this particular time. So many hurting and homeless people are contacting us daily, but we're able to help them because of each one of you that are praying, caring, and sharing at this time. Tell your family, certain friends about NLEC TV and get directly involved yourself.
Stacey Abrams. She received degrees from Spelman College, the LBJ School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas, and Yale Law School. She founded the New Georgia Project, which submitted more than 200,000 registrations for voters of color between 2014 and 2016. In 2018, Abrams became the Democratic nominee for governor of Georgia, winning more votes than any other Democrat in the state's history. Abrams was the first black woman to become the gubernatorial nominee for a major party in the United States, and she was the first black woman and first Georgian to deliver a response to the State of the Union. On August 17, 2019, Abrams announced the founding of Fair Fight 2020, an organization to assist Democrats financially and technically to build over voter protection teams in 20 states. Stacey Abrams.
Now you can take NLEC TV anywhere as you put the NLEC TV app on your iPhone or mobile device. NLEC TV is an innovative TV station that's on the cutting edge of community service. On NLEC TV, you'll discover wholesome family, community, renewable energy, and inspirational programming. Those needing energy assistance, food, clothing, or freedom from the cycle of homelessness will find that plus much more on NLEC TV. Now, you can receive NLEC TV by going to 24.2 on your television set or putting the NLEC TV app on your iPhone or mobile device. For further information, call 314-436-2424 or go to nlecstl.org. That's nlecstl.org.
And welcome back. Reverend Darryl Gray, organizer for Expect Us, is my guest today. But that's just one of the hats that he wears. He wears so many different hats, and they're all progressive hats. And it's, Reverend Gray, how do you find your time? How do you bide your time with doing so many different things?
I think it has to be based upon, trying to determine what is the critical need.
Mm-hmm.
We have to deal with what, politically we call low-hanging fruit. What things can we be successful in right now? And so let me give you an example. I was with former Mayor Lida Cruz, and I was asked to serve on a corrections task force. It was right after four or five uprisings in the Criminal Justice Center downtown. And myself, Adolphus Pruitt, former Senator Jamila Nasheed, Reverend Charles Norris and the AME Church and others were asked to investigate the Criminal Justice Correction Center to see if the complaints raised by the detainees there were valid. And what we found was that we had a criminal a corrections facility and system that was in tatters and had to be dealt with immediately. One of the main things that came out of that, Dr. Hayes, is the recommendation for a corrections task force, civilian Oversight Board, similar to the Police Oversight Board. These are things that we believe can bring accountability and transparency to what we believe has been a broken correction system. We look at, for example, the voter suppression bills that are being presented throughout this country. 43 different states are pushing for voter suppression bills, voter ID laws, the big lie, trying to fix a problem that doesn't exist. And what it'll end up doing is minimizing black voter turnout, pushing black against black voter turnout. So, you know, we look at that as a critical issue. We look at that as a timely issue because it determines so much. We looked at COVID. When COVID first hit the black community and hit us disproportionately, we had to make sure that there were testing centers. We had to make sure that black people who are already dealing with underlying conditions got testing, got vaccinated, and that we got the vaccines to people. These are critical issues. Sure. So you've got to determine what the critical issues are and deal with those things that are most timely. Mm-hmm.
Reverend, you must have 100% support from your family. Tell us about that.
My wife is extremely supportive of me. She is my rock. She keeps me focused. She reminds me that I'm just human. She reminds me that if I allow my work to wear me out, to wear me down, then what will end up happening? I'll be rolled to the side and somebody will say next. She encourages me to pace myself. I'm a prayerful person. And I believe that the Spirit of God is upon me. And that it not only does it motivate me, but it focuses me. It reminds me when to move quickly. But it also, I'm reminded that Jesus took a break too, that Jesus slept too. And so I take time out. I make sure that I exercise self-care. It's something that we do within the Expect Us movement. We look out for each other. We remind each other that we're simply human. And a lot of these problems have existed for centuries, and we're not going to solve them in one day, in one action. So I'm always mindful of that.
Mm-hmm. I was going to ask you, what do you prioritize? But with all the different organizations that you lead and are involved in, looks like you prioritize each one. Is there one specific, especially with this voter suppression movement going on and the conviction of the Chauvin on George Floyd, is there any particular item or focus that you're geared upon right now?
I think there are three priorities that I am involved in. Police violence, obviously, but violence, community violence, the violence that we're committing among ourselves. We're already on pace to have more murders in this city this year than we did last year. We've got to respond to that. And then finally, you're absolutely right, voter suppression. Okay. We've got to prepare ourselves now for the 2022 election. So those are three of the priorities that I focus on. But Jesse Jackson, whom I worked with, also said something to me, Dr. Hayes. He said, we don't have the luxury of doing one thing at a time.
I understand. Reverend, we are out of time, but this has been so inspiring and so inspirational and so sincere. I still want to thank you again for taking time out during this pandemic and come visit with us. And please continue to do what you're doing. We respect you so much, and we're going to expect you and respect you. So, Reverend Darryl Gray, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hayes. It's always a pleasure being with you.
Have a great day. And each and one of you, thank you for supporting the New Life Evangelistic Center, Sound 24.2, and Reverend Larry Rice and his mission. I'm Bernie Hayes. Have a great day, and please stay safe.